Hi there, my name is Xavier, and the fact that I have blue eyes, blonde hair, and an average height is all encoded into my DNA. It's nature's way of storing data. But could we also use it to store digital data? Things like photos, documents, music, and videos? And if we could, why would we? What are the pros and cons of storing data in DNA, and what problems does it solve? But before answering these questions, let's take a look at how we've been storing data up until today. The vast majority of our data is currently stored on magnetic media, like hard drives or tapes. Some of it is stored on optical media, like CDs and DVDs. However, our modern storage techniques have a few flaws. They're not robust, have a low information density, and each media requires a special device to read and write data. Let's look at each of these problems in more detail and see how DNA can help. Let's start with robustness, or rather, lack thereof. Hard drives are pretty unreliable, with between 1 and 3% of drives dying within their first year. In subsequent years, that rises to over 10%. Tape drives are a bit better and are designed to last for up to 30 years if they are stored in a controlled environment. You might wonder why robustness is so important. Well, humanity has generated more data in the last few years than in all of history, and yet, within a few hundred years, none of it would be left unless we keep copying it to newer drives. That's a big problem for historical data that could be invaluable in the future. DNA, on the other hand, is very robust. In 1991, the mummy of Ötzi the Iceman was found in the Alps. He died over 5,000 years ago, and yet we were still able to extract his DNA, read it, and find out that he was lactose intolerant and that he still has living relatives in Austria today. If Ötzi had been carrying a hard drive with him, we wouldn't be able to read it 30 years after his death, let alone after 5,000 years. You could say that DNA is nature's oldest and most robust storage media. You can store it forever, but it can easily last a few centuries. The second problem that we currently face is information density. This is Facebook's cold storage data centers in Oregon. It is over 5,700 square meters in size and can store approximately 1 exabyte of data. That is over 1,000 petabytes and over 1 billion gigabytes. That sounds impressive, but if you want to store all of the data that was generated in 2018, you would need 33,000 of these data centers. Yikes. How does DNA compare, you ask? Well, theoretically, you can store 1 zettabyte of data in a single gram of DNA. That's 1 billion terabytes, the equivalent of 71 million of the biggest hard drives available today. But that's theory. Currently, we can only store 250 petabytes per gram of DNA, which means we could replace this entire data center with just 5 grams of DNA. This insane density allows us to store all of the world's information in a very small footprint. It also means that we don't have to choose what data we want to store for future generations. We can just store all of it in DNA. Heck, you could even say that humans are huge data capsules. We have over 37 trillion cells in our bodies, each containing a copy of our full DNA. And if you know that the human genome is 750 megabytes in size, then we are carrying 37 trillion times 750 megabytes. Which is a huge amount of information. The final problem I'd like to highlight is that every advancement in storing data has required a new way to read it. The 3.5-inch floppy disk was hugely popular in the 80s and 90s, and yet, barely 40 years later, we can hardly use them because our computers don't have a reader for them anymore. The same thing goes for optical storage media, like CDs and DVDs. DNA, on the other hand, was not a human invention. It's been around since the beginning of life and has always had the same properties. DNA readers or sequencers built today can read all DNA, even old DNA like the one from Ötzi. It's also future-proof because DNA is becoming a key technology in areas such as biology, forensics, and medicine. All right, you probably agree with me that DNA is the future of data storage. But how do you actually store data in it? Well, traditionally, we store data in binary form, meaning with zeros and ones. In a hard drive, the zeros are represented by areas on the disk which aren't magnetized, and the ones by areas which are. DNA is made up of 4 components, adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine, also referred to as ATC and G. This means that we have now 4 distinct values instead of 2, so we have to rework our binary files. Instead of storing each 0 or 1 individually, we store them in pairs of 2, like this. Once we have that, we can encode the data into synthetic DNA. This is exactly like the real stuff, the only difference being that synthetic DNA is not stored inside a living cell. Now that our data is stored inside DNA, we can read it with a DNA sequencer. This deconstructs the DNA and reads out all the ATCs and Gs. However, this process is not perfect and read errors might occur. The sequencer might not be able to read a certain bit of DNA because it's damaged, or it might say that it read an A instead of a T. And when that happens, how can we make sure that we can still recover the data? In our own bodies, there are proteins active that find damaged or mutated DNA and try to repair them. If the damage is too big, they can even kill the entire cell to prevent spreading the bad DNA further. But that's organic DNA. In synthetic DNA, we don't have these proteins. So we can add what's called error-correcting codes into the data that we store in DNA. The DNA fountain method, for instance, uses fountain codes to correct errors in data. And this is also used for broadcasting TV signals. So how do these error-correcting codes work? Simple. Imagine you want to store 3 digits, 5, 9, and 17, and that you want to be able to recover all 3 of them, even if one of them can be read. To do that, you can store the sum of all 3 of them as well. Now, when the number 9 gets corrupted, you can recalculate it by subtracting the numbers from the sum. This is a very simple error-correcting code, but it demonstrates how the concept works. By adding fountain codes to your DNA-encoded data, you can make sure that you can always read it back, even when some ATCs or Gs can be read correctly. Okay, so that's reading DNA, but can we also copy DNA? Traditionally, with hard drives, where we want to copy data, we have to read every single bit from one drive and store it on another. DNA, by contrast, can be copied millions of times using a polymerase chain reaction. This is, for instance, used in forensics to make copies of scarce DNA samples. If you then screw something up, you still have some copies left. The same technique can also be applied to synthetic DNA that contains data. The only downside is that by copying DNA, you introduce some noise and the quality is reduced. But we can overcome this with our error-correcting codes. Using DNA as a storage medium seems like a no-brainer. But there are some downsides as well, mainly the cost of it all. Creating or synthesizing DNA is an expensive process, coming in at $3,500 per megabyte. That's a bit expensive if you consider that a hard drive can do the same for less than a penny. However, we have to see this in context. The first hard drive made by IBM in 1956 could store 5 megabytes at a price of $10,000 per megabyte. Hey, we have to start somewhere. Reading or sequencing your DNA is a bit more affordable. You can have your own DNA sequenced for less than $1,000. It is, however, a bit time consuming, as your entire DNA has to be sequenced, even if you're only interested in a small part of it. But that is changing. Microsoft has demonstrated a technique that allows us to randomly read a part of DNA. So, time for a conclusion then. DNA data storage seems like the future, but it will take some time before we can phase out our trusty hard drives. Costs have to come down first before it can be considered a viable alternative. But as history has shown, that's only a matter of time. And when it does, it will allow us to store an incredible amount of data in a very small space, allowing us to archive data for generations to come. So, what's your opinion on DNA data storage? Let me know in the comments below. And if you like this video, hit the thumbs up button and consider getting subscribed. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Oh, and by the way, if you want to learn more about this topic, you can check out the sources that I've used to make this video in the description below. There are a few interesting papers in there that are worth a read. Enjoy!